Good evening, everyone. My name is John Hughes, and I am the music director of the Chicago Master Singers. Welcome to another session of CMS University. Whether you have sung in a concert with us, maybe you've attended a concert, or maybe you're just joining us through the power of the internet, I'm glad you're here, and I hope you feel part of our online community. It's really important that we stick together during these difficult times when we're staying home and trying to be socially distanced. And I'm glad you're here, and I hope that you feel part of our community. One way that we are trying to achieve that is through this YouTube live stream. We thought about a number of different platforms, but we settled on YouTube because of the interaction that it allows. So make sure you're logged into YouTube, and then you'll be able to participate in the chat. And you can see people are saying hello, sharing where they're watching from, and it's a really great opportunity to build an online community. It also allows you to ask me questions. I just ask that you start any questions for me with 3 or 4 question marks. That way, when I do have the chance to look over and glance at the chat window, I can quickly identify what's meant for me. I can then put it up on the screen and I'll try my best to answer it. Okay, with that said, let's get into our topic for tonight, which is conductor silent processes. Often conductors are referred to as the silent artists. While we may be in charge of the performance in a great way, we actually don't make any sound ourselves, right? That's all the musicians in front of us. And so there's a lot of kind of mystery about what exactly do conductors do? And hopefully we'll dispel some myths tonight and answer your questions and maybe give you some insight into all that goes into conducting beyond just waving our arms. Now, to get us started thinking about conducting, I picked out 4 cartoons that kind of poke fun at conducting and at the musicians, and we'll start there. So I'll just show them briefly here and then we'll discuss them. All right, and here's number 2. Number 3. And then finally, number 4. So what are some things that you notice in these? First of all, I notice that no one seems to understand what the conductor does, right? It seems like the conductor is maybe kind of a fool, just kind of reading instructions, you know, go up and down until the music stops and then turn around and bow. Sometimes one of the cartoons portrayed the conductor as the musicians judging the conductor, and then the conductor similarly judging the musician. So there was maybe some animosity going on there. The audience members, that final cartoon, kind of very intrigued by watching this conducting. So I think a lot of people are watching this. I'd also just point out, and just as a quick aside, that in all 4 of these cartoons, the conductors were all male, which is a sad stereotype as well. So what do conductors do? Let's start by maybe just talking about what the word conductor means. It's used in a lot of arenas in our daily lives. So the first one would be music, right? The leader of a musical ensemble. That's what a conductor is. So that's maybe the obvious one. We also have conductor used in relation to transportation, right? We talk about a train conductor, right? This has a parallel to music, although it might not seem like it. But a lot of what musical conductors do is get people on and off, right? Cue people, release, you know, do cutoffs, making sure that we're all on the train going the same direction, right? So there is a parallel here. Similarly, there's a parallel to the electricity and how conductor is used in that sense, meaning it's transmitting electrical energy from one object to another. That's what we do as conductors too, right? We're transmitting our energy, our interpretation, our vision for a piece to an ensemble and then out to the audience behind us, right? So there's a similarity there. An archaic use of the word conductor is a military officer. And certainly at times we have to be drill sergeants in a positive way and encourage people, have high standards, set a role model for what discipline looks like. And so all of this goes into being a conductor. It's much more than just waving our arms. So what exactly do conductors do? If it's more than just waving our arms, why don't we talk about it? It's really similar or analogous to this metaphor of an iceberg, where we have 10% of conducting is above the water. That would be showing up at rehearsals and performances. And then 90% is below the water. And that 90% is done in solitude and in silence. I think a lot of people might think that conducting is this very glamorous thing where you get to show up and be in charge and then leave. But a lot of it, in my experience, is spending a lot of time by yourself in silence doing things that are very menial and repetitive and not glamorous. So let me talk a little bit about some of those tasks and the other roles that we play in addition to being the leader of an ensemble. So this is just a quick brainstorm I did of the different roles I see myself playing, and these are in no particular order. The first would be librarian, right? Making sure everyone has copies of the music, all the players have orchestral parts, they're all marked accordingly, making sure there are just materials available. We are servants. We serve many different entities. We serve the ensemble members in front of us, the audience members who come to hear a performance. We serve the composers whose music we are performing, we're recreating, whether they are alive or have passed away, we are serving them. And we are also serving the high art form of choral music or just music in general, right? So we are servants. We're speakers. We speak publicly at a rehearsal, many times at concerts, and I'm even speaking to you on YouTube right now, so maybe I should add YouTuber to this little word cloud as well. We're psychologists. We stand up and we have to read the room in a rehearsal, knowing when we need to insert a joke, knowing when it might be time to move on from that difficult section or passage and do something different. Even knowing when, okay, we've been sitting a while, let's stand up and really sing this, right? So we have to have a kind of sense of nonverbal communication. We're historians. We study lots of music from lots of different time periods. We contextualize it within what was happening culturally at the time and in the region, as well as contextualizing it within a certain composer's output. Is this early Beethoven or late Beethoven, for example? We're communicators. So much of conducting is communicating, not just speaking, but almost all nonverbal, right? Getting facial expressions, eye contact, sometimes withholding eye contact, right? So that we are able to communicate big ideas subtly and with very few words, if any. We're logistics coordinators, telling people what time to come, what to wear, where to park, what door to enter, all of those things. We're motivators, trying to get all the people in the room to pull in one direction. That's a very difficult thing to do. And we have to do it kindly and in an encouraging way, but still so that we are all working together. We're storytellers. We don't just, not just telling a good joke in a rehearsal, although that is important, but that's what we're doing through a performance, right? We are telling a story, whether it's the story of Messiah in the Handel piece or a collection of pieces, we're taking the audience on a journey, and we have to pace that performance, that experience, in a similar way. I think we're a consensus builder. Again, we're getting, you know, 100 people in the choir and 60 people in an orchestra, again, to pull together in the same direction. We're an artist, right? We're trying to tap into what makes us human and express that and help other people find their humanity through music. We're constant. I think about this all the time, especially these days during COVID when we're all doing things very differently. And what one thing that I try and do as a conductor is really be kind of a steady, calm, assured presence. Because there are times, even in regular, you know, pre-COVID times when rehearsals maybe aren't going well and the concert's coming up, and your job as a conductor is to relax everyone, have a plan, project confidence, and continue on. We're leaders, right? We're setting the tone for rehearsals, and we are leading people through the process of making music. We're linguists. We studied lots of different languages, and not just how to pronounce something, let's say in Italian, but also understanding what the words are saying. What is the text meaning? So a lot of us are very great lovers of poems and text, especially in choral music, because that's so much where we get our meaning from. We're recruiters, not just bringing more people into an ensemble, but recruiting audience members, making sure that we are serving our patrons as well. J.S. Bach said that a vast majority of being a musician is custodial, right? Setting up chairs, music stands, risers. We all chip in and do that. And again, it's not always showing up in a tuxedo. It's doing the hard part too. We're visionaries. Anyone who's ever sat through the beginning of a rehearsal sequence, you pull out a new piece and you go through that read through and it's like, how are we ever going to do this? And we have a concert when? We have to be able to see a uncut diamond and picture it fully polished and cut and set in a beautiful gold ring. That is our job, and to inspire people to share that vision with us. I believe that conductors are shepherds, that we feed our people, that we nourish them, we encourage them, and we help them discover beauty in their lives. We're managers, again, trying to get everyone on the same page. We're hosts. I talked about this before, about having the table spread before everyone so that people come to a rehearsal or a concert and feel that they've been thought of in advance and feel like they are taken care of and that there's a plan and that they kind of know what to expect. I think we're teachers, not just of notes and rhythms, but teachers of beauty and identifying beauty in our lives through music. Being sensitive to why does that particular chord sound so good? Even if it's a dissonant chord, what is it that pulls at our heartstrings? So we're teaching people to be sensitive to the beauty of the world around us. And we are coaches, right? We are pushing you to go farther than you might believe you can, and encouraging you and rewarding you when it works. So that's a lot of the roles that we play as a conductor. Now, I want to talk about some more tangible tasks, and these are kind of roughly in a chronological order for how I would prepare for a concert. The first thing on it would be to choose a repertoire, right? That seems fairly obvious. Now, choosing the repertoire is maybe more complex than you might assume. It's not just that we go to our shelf and say, oh, I haven't done this piece for a while, or I've always wanted to do that piece. Yeah, conductors need to always believe in the pieces that they are programming. I believe that deeply. You can't conduct something you don't believe in. But sometimes we just can't choose something either, and we're often limited by things that aren't glamorous. You know, it might be the size of the stage that we're going to perform on doesn't allow an orchestra to be the big enough orchestra that's required to fit on that stage, or the performance venue doesn't have an organ and this piece requires an organ, or the expense of hiring the number of players needed to do it. Sometimes we're just limited by these factors. And so we have to kind of live within our means. And choosing repertoire is so important to an ensemble's overall success. It's the greatest determinant. So you want to make sure it's within the ensemble's grasp artistically, that it's something the audience will appreciate and something that you believe in as well. We then have to order music. This might seem fairly simple, but I'm mostly thinking about ordering it for ourselves so that we have time to study it. If I were to start a rehearsal of the Verdi Requiem in August, I wouldn't want to be getting that music in July, right? That's going to take a long time to prepare. So we have to be kind of thinking several years in advance, especially for pieces like that. Then we have to learn music. And this is the majority of what I do, is sit alone at a desk with a bunch of pens of different colors, and we're going to talk all about that in a minute, and rulers, and sit and learn music. So what does that mean as a conductor? Well, it means going from very objective things that you can't change to more subjective things. So again, this is roughly chronological, and I'll go through this in more detail, but I always start with the text because this is where most composers started. So I understand the text, I understand the translation, I understand the pronunciation, and everything that goes into it. What is the poem or the text saying? Then I'm going to look at the structure of the piece, right? How is it put together? It's really similar to looking at a blueprint and then envisioning how this is all going to come together into a beautiful home, right? So we have to kind of take this black ink and make sense of it. Find where is there repeated things? Are there variations? You know, it's not if 10 measures from the beginning come back later on, you know, the composer doesn't write, these are the same as earlier, right? That's your job as a conductor to kind of realize the structure of the piece. Then I'm going to look at the notes and rhythms and the harmonies and make sure I understand them. And again, if this was Mozart, I will look differently at the harmonies because it's common practice era, right? So I can basically account for every note because it's so tonally based, versus something by a modern composer, which may be kind of pushing the boundaries of tonality. I'm going to look at those harmonies differently. I'm going to make sure I know how to sing and all the rhythms of every part, so that I have an idea. And it's not just that I can sing them, but I can sing them the way I want them to be sung, right? So with all the phrasing, etc. Then I'm going to look at the phrasing. I think often young conductors start putting in breath markings right away. And you'll notice that I, over my experience, have pushed this later and later. I'm going to then start to think about, after I've learned everything else, kind of the objective things I can't change, like the notes and the rhythms, then I'm going to start to look at more subjective things. And I'm going to ask myself, what's the stress point in each phrase? Who's most important in each measure? How am I going to think about this tempo or dynamics, articulations? How long is this fermata? Are we going to do the fermata and then, you know, we're going to hold the fermata and then go straight on without taking a breath? Are we going to hold the fermata, cut off, and then go on with a little breath in between? Are we going to hold the fermata, do a complete break, and then go on? Right, so I'm going to make all those decisions. I'm going to think about the dynamics too. Is the forte on page 10 different than the forte on page 3? It might be, right? And even though it's marked the same. So there's a lot of kind of decision making that goes in that is takes a lot of time to think about. And there are a couple things that go into making these decisions. First of all, it's kind of getting in the composer's head. And that's why experience is so important. You start to get to know different composers' personalities differently. So for example, someone like Brahms, who was a conductor himself, he marks so much in his music. He puts all these tempo indications and articulations and everything. There's not a lot of guesswork about how Brahms wanted something to be phrased. And another person like that would be Randall Thompson. He marked almost every note in Thompson's score has an articulation marking on it. So you kind of start to get into composers' heads. And when you have a composer like Brahms or Thompson, and you want to do something different, then you're going to have to justify that, right? Because if they didn't put a staccato marking on a note, then they probably didn't want to, that, because they, every other time they wanted a staccato, they marked it. That stands in contrast to maybe earlier music like Palestrina or Victoria that doesn't have a lot of articulation markings. Then you have a little bit more freedom, right? So you kind of get to know these different composers' ideas and personalities and can start to make judgments based on that. I will say that, again, not everything that I per se want to do, I can do always, right? Sometimes I'm just limited. For example, if you're performing in a very reverberant hall, maybe you're going to have to take that fermata and hold it and do a full release to allow the room to clear before you go on, right? Or maybe you want to do Messiah and you want to take these choruses super fast, but you know that your singers might not be able to go that fast, right? So sometimes we're kind of pushing the boundary, but living, again, kind of within our artistic means. All of this is then going to kind of funnel into developing teaching strategies. Excuse me. So when I'm learning notes and rhythms, I'm thinking about, okay, where are the problem spots? I'm trying to predict where we will struggle, and then I'm going to try and mitigate that right away. And I do that through contextual warm-ups or how I structure the rehearsals, right? Very rarely, if we're doing an octavo length piece, will I rehearse starting at the beginning of a piece. I will often pick the heart of the piece or the most difficult part and then kind of expand outward from that to try and get to root it out before it becomes a problem. So my score study is always trying to be predictive and respond to mistakes that I think could happen. And again, that comes from experience of leading choirs for as long as I have. I know I look young, but I've been doing this a while, so I can kind of predict where trouble spots might be. Finally, we'll practice the choreography. And this does matter. We do practice conducting, how to actually wave our arms. And, you know, some pieces take more time to kind of get into your body. There is a muscle memory aspect. Some pieces take more time than others. If it's something really fast and multi-metered, like the beginning of Britain's Rejoice in the Lamb, yeah, we're going to spend a little bit more time in front of a mirror practicing that than something like the Mozart Ave Verum Corpus, which is really fairly easy to conduct from the standpoint of keeping the tempo and everything. But in that piece, we're going to work more on phrasing and showing what we want that way. So these are just some of the process of how we learn music. All of this then is going to lead into the development of a mental aural ideal. By this, I mean we are trying to get into our head a very, very specific ideal that we are going to go for in rehearsal and performance. And we try and walk into the very first rehearsal in August with this ideal in our mind that is for a concert in November, right? Our goal is to be more clear in our ideal at the first rehearsal than the ensemble will be at the performance. We want to be so crystal clear. So this means being able to not only to hear the piece in its entirety in silence, right, that we can hear it, but really hearing it in detail. Hearing how long is that staccato in the viola part? Is that a staccato or a leggero? How long is it, right? What's the detail that we are hearing in? And then the rehearsal process is matching the ensemble in front of us to our ideal. Now, sometimes our ideal might change depending on just limiting factors. Sometimes it's not possible to do what we wanted to, or maybe what we wanted to doesn't actually sound all that good. But the point is to be at the point where we can hear the whole piece and have that plan for an interpretation going in, and then adjust to the people in front of us as necessary. All right. After we do all that, then we have to start the rehearsal planning process. And this is not just practicing, you know, or planning what we're going to do on a Monday night from 7 to 10. And we're going to spend 20 minutes on this piece and 10 minutes on this, etc. That is definitely important, and you have to have a good plan going into a rehearsal. But we also have to be considering what goes into an entire performance sequence. So if we're doing a multi-movement work like Elijah, right, we don't want to be 2 weeks from a concert and never having done three movements before, right? We have to be pacing ourselves through that process, making sure that we're covering everything, making sure we know which choruses are more difficult than others, and starting with those ones, right? Front loading the work. One way that I do this is I make, this is just one example. This is for the Mozart Solemn Vespers. This is just an instrumentation chart of who's in what movement, right? So here's the timing of each movement. So I just kind of have a rough estimation of that. The name of the movement, the piano vocal score, so I know what page the choir is on, and who's playing in each movement, what solos there are, what measures the soloists are singing, etc. Now, this can help plan like a dress rehearsal because you don't have to rehearse in order, right? So you'll notice that the trumpets and timpani only play on the first and last movements. So maybe we do movement 1 and 6 first, and then dismiss the trumpet and timpani. And then maybe we do 2 and 3 because they use SATB soloists. And then after movement 3, we dismiss the alto tenor bass soloist. Then we jump to movement 5 and do the big soprano solo, the Laudate Dominum. Then dismiss her, and then end with the Laudate Pueri, which has no soloist, no trumpet, no timpani, right? So we're being very economical with our use of people, that we aren't keeping them there for a long time with nothing to do. And we're kind of going from bigger to smaller. You'll notice also just kind of thinking about where the soloists stand when they sit, right? All of this needs to happen well in advance so that, again, we're kind of a gracious host and making sure people feel thought of in advance and that we know what we're doing, right? That we have a plan. I think it's most important to have a plan. You can always deviate from it, but the most important thing is to know what you're doing going into it. After we do that, we want to make sure we have the necessary soloists hired and that that we get all the parts to them, that they know what time to arrive, etc. We're going to do this within the context of a budget. And then finally, we get to conduct, right? So there's a lot that goes into it before we actually even get to the first rehearsal. Okay, why don't we stop here? I know the chat has been going vigorously, and I'll try my best to get to all the questions here. But let me see. Here's one. Is it tricky to decide how to teach a piece to the choir if you focus on rhythm first, then bad diction might get baked in, for example? Yeah, so teaching strategies, you know, this gets to every piece is going to be different. And the way that I would teach a piece by Bach would be very, very different from a piece by Lauridsen, right? Because they're approaching music very differently. So again, I'm going to the heart of the piece. Is this piece about the text? Is it about the melody? Is it about rhythm? And I'm going to enter the piece through that and kind of make sure that the kind of quintessential element of the piece is first established and then move to the other parts. Jackie Shaw says, I would say the conductor also embodies the personality of the choir. There are strict formal choirs and witty fun choirs, and that really depends on the conductor. I agree. And I think, you know, that sometimes it's, again, kind of a consensus building, right? That the conductor has to respond to the choir in front of them. But I also think that, you know, conductors aren't going to be successful if they're not being themselves, right? And I know there are many, many conductors who have these great personalities and they're so funny and so witty, and I can't ever be like that, right? And so what I try and do is learn from them what I can and be the best version of myself with choirs. And that takes a certain amount of bravery to kind of be like, yeah, I see that person and they're awesome, but I do this and that's okay. And we just ask that our ensembles respect that we're kind of being authentic and genuine to ourselves. And I think in my experience, that's always worked. And yeah, sometimes conductors' personalities kind of come out through their choir too. Linda, I'm sorry, your comment got cut off here, but the conductor is not only the musical leader of the choir, but I don't know, I think maybe kind of the face of the choir, right? The public facing aspect is important too. Kim, how do you decide which edition of a piece to use? Publishers have many variations. You're right. I mean, certain publishers I trust more than others. Like Baron-Reiter, I think you can't go wrong with Baron-Reiter or Carus, Oxford. So those, I will always look for those too. And I look to see if it's a critical edition, what manuscripts they use. I talk to other conductors. I'll say, you know, what version did you use? And a good music dealer, like the one I work with, Musical Resources of Toledo, Ohio, you can call them and have that discussion. But that is an important decision. I know, for example, there's one edition of the Vivaldi Gloria that is like missing stuff and it's not right. And a lot of people get duped by that. So there are some kind of notorious pieces out there that you do have to be careful of making sure you get a quality edition. Do you like to have the chorus do a complete read through of each piece before digging in and learning, rehearsing it? I think that depends. I don't mean to cop out on that, but you know, if it's a piece I know that like CMS knows, like Messiah or Mozart Requiem, yeah, I'll probably have them read it. If it's some brand new piece that I know they haven't seen, then I might do more like a contextual warm-ups and more of an introduction to it so that to help them get into the piece faster. Let's see if there's any more. Okay, we'll take one more and then we're going to go on. Obviously, you are familiar with many recordings of many works. When you're preparing to conduct a work, either for the first time, do you avoid listening to other conductors' takes on the piece? This is a great question, Michelle. I'm glad you asked it. So if it's a piece I've never heard before, of course I'm going to listen to it before I program it, right? Because choosing to program a piece is a significant time. You're investing time and money into doing this piece, right? So yeah, if I don't know it, I'm going to listen to it. After that, once I get into the score study process, I don't listen to it. For that very reason that you said, I don't want their interpretation to affect mine. What I've found to be most useful is to listen to other various recordings of other works by that composer. So, for example, if we were doing the Haydn Mass in Time of War, one of the late great masses that he wrote, I would listen to lots of different conductors' recordings of the other late great masses of Haydn. That way I'm getting ideas about his style and how to interpret it without it being specific to that piece that I'm preparing. Oftentimes singers will ask me, well, what recording should we listen to? And I don't really like to answer that question because I want you to be responsive to me and not go on, well, Robert Shaw did it this way or Harry Christophers did it that way, right? So I want you to be in the moment with me too. So I try and avoid that question. Good. Thank you, Michelle. We'll do one more here from Jackie. That time management chart you had with the instruments and soloists, is that something that gets taught on conducting courses? I've never thought about all the planning involved. I have charts everywhere, right? Of, you know, even down to, I have 10 rehearsals to do Mozart Requiem. This is, we're on rehearsal one, we're going to do these movements. Rehearsal two, we're going to do these. At rehearsal five, we're going to run all the movements. 6, 7, 8, we're going to do this. 9 and 10 are run-throughs and punch lists, right? So I do that frequently for myself and the instrumentation chart as well. So I have kind of three or four charts that I do for every kind of large-scale piece that I conduct. Are these taught in graduate programs? Yes, to some extent. I would say, you know, every conductor is a little different. I think a lot of people would view me as being overly fastidious, maybe too type A. But to me, it's really a discipline, right? It's not that I always need to do this, but it's kind of holding myself accountable for being as prepared as possible. This is something that I've gleaned from other conductors that I've studied with, and so I'm certainly not the first to come up with this. Okay, I now want to actually spend a little bit of time walking you through a piece that I am currently studying. This summer, I'm going to be, hopefully, if this vaccine all works, I'm going to be doing a Lauridsen concert, and of all the music by Lauridsen, and I'm starting the process now of studying these scores. And the one I'm just kind of working on the past couple of weeks is the first movement of the Madrigali by Lauridsen. These are six fire songs on Italian Renaissance poems. So I want to talk about how I've approached this. This is a 3-minute piece. I would venture to say that I've spent probably 10 hours on this piece so far in my study, and I bet it will be at least another 10 hours before I feel comfortable performing it. So again, I'm going to be going mostly from objective things to subjective things. Okay, so what does that mean? Instead of getting even into the music right away, the first thing I did was look at this text, right? Here's the Italian. This is the text that we'll be singing. Here's the English translation, right? So now I'm looking at just what does the text mean? Do I understand what the poem is about? I numbered the lines so that then I could write them in the score, so I didn't have to remember every single word of the translation. And then by doing that, I noticed that there are 14 lines, so now I know that it's a sonnet, right? And that's important to understand the structure of the piece. Okay, then I read the description that Lauridsen writes here, and this is very helpful. He talks about the main organizing element of these six madrigali is this fire chord, which I notated here, which is a B flat minor chord with a ninth in it. Right, so a very dissonant chord with that C against the D flat, yeah? So we have, right, that's the fire chord. So it's helpful to just read, you know, all this kind of front matter that as a younger singer or whatever, I might have skipped over. And then you'll quickly see that the first chord in the piece is indeed that fire chord. Then I would then look at the whole piece from a 30,000 foot level, right? Before even looking at the notes and rhythms, just kind of getting a sense of what's happening, I noticed here that there's a DS el senio, right? Or I'm sorry, DS, so go to the senio and then skip to the coda marking, right? So making sure I just understand where this is and where it goes back to, and here's the coda, right? So again, just kind of getting that structural part down. At the bottom of this page, at the very end, it says to Robert Shaw, right? The great American conductor who was at Atlanta for so many years, right? So if I didn't know who Robert Shaw was, that would have been something I looked up and maybe explored. Well, why did Lauridsen dedicate this piece to Robert Shaw? Okay, after that then, I very kind of menial things. It's nothing exciting, but one thing that's kind of frustrating about this edition, and this is the only edition of the piece, is that it numbers the measures, or measures the numbers, every 5 measures. It doesn't matter whether the measure is at the left-hand side or not, it just does every 5 measures. So 5, 10, 15, 20, etc. That drives me nuts, because then when I'm trying to lead a rehearsal and I can't find the measure number, right? So I wrote in, you know, in the margins, what measure is at the left, the the first measure of each system so that I know what that is. Okay, then I got out all my pens and I have developed the system over time. This isn't something that I was necessarily taught, but it's just idiosyncratic to me. And what I do is take several passes through the piece and look for different things to highlight. So the first thing I looked at here was the key signature. And I always highlight that in orange. Now this one is the only key signature. It doesn't change keys throughout the piece. So that was easy. But I looked through the piece and looked for it throughout. Then I went back to the beginning and I did time signatures. And I highlight those in yellow. So you'll see throughout here that he's changing time signatures fairly frequently, right? So I'm highlighting all those. You'll notice here that often I'll put kind of a big four if we're going to four or three. Here it's in pencil, 3 plus 2 for this 5, because I'm not exactly sure yet. I haven't decided. So that for now is in pencil. But you'll notice that again, these are very objective things, right? All I'm doing is basically adult coloring. All right, after that then, I'm gonna look at the tempo markings. Lauridsen is going to trying to get this very impassioned sense of kind of rubato and speeding up and slowing down, trying to articulate this very unrequited love poem, right? So he makes all these subtle changes here throughout. Adding writs. Now we're at 112. Now we have a molto writ. Then we have 120. Then we retard again here. Then we're at 108. Then we writ. Now we're at 96, right? So he's asking for very minute levels of tempo changes. And these are not big in the music, right? They're just little things, but we have to pay attention to them and make sure we learn the music accordingly. You'll also notice that sometimes here I decided that we're going to actually subdivide those last two eighth notes to get that molto ritardando, right? So I'm starting to think maybe a little bit more subjectively about I'm going to grab those last two eighth notes and subdivide so that we really perform a molto rit versus at the top of the page where he just asked for a writ, right? So I'm trying to distinguish between those two things. After that, then, I'm going to go back to the beginning, right? So now I'm going over the piece over and over and over again. And I'll circle in blue any dynamic marking. And again, he does a lot of these. I'll also, if there are kind of the hairpin crescendos that look like this, I'll put those in red and green, kind of green for crescendo and red for decrescendo, right? And then a number of these, though, are ones that I've added in based on the phrasing, which I haven't even gotten to yet, right? I'm just still kind of in objective mode. Then I'm going to think about the articulations. How long is a fermata? How long, what does he mean by all these? He puts at the beginning all these tenuto markings, right, which I've highlighted in pink. What do those mean? And how is it different than when he doesn't have a tenuto marking on a note? How are we going to perform those differently? Then I got into the text, right, and not just understanding the text, what it means, but the translation, what each word means, and then a poetic translation above. I put things in IPA, the International Phonetic Alphabet, making sure I understand how to pronounce all the Latin or Italian. And when I wrote in these translations, I discovered that he at times repeats the text out of order. And that's not native to the poem. Lauridsen was choosing to come back to certain lines and even just parts of lines and interject them throughout the poem to highlight them, right? So going through very carefully, then I understand, oh, this is what he's really trying to say here. He's repeating this text, and so that's really, he must think that's really important, right? After that, then, I went through the harmony. And again, this piece is very different than studying a Mozart score where, you know, every note, every chord is changing on the beat, you can account for the chords very easily, and it's maybe a little bit different than this kind of chord where we have a B flat, a G flat, a C flat, and an E flat. Let me move that up so you can see it. B flat, G flat, C flat, E flat. Right? They don't teach you that in Music Theory 101, right? So you have to decipher, okay, those upper three parts, G flat, C flat, and E flat, are a C flat major chord in second inversion. Right? That doesn't sound so scary. But it's that bass B flat against the C flat and the altos that makes the piece bite, right? So now I can then teach the choir, okay, everyone sing but the basses. That's easy. Now add the basses, right? Now let's do that phrase with just the bass and alto. So we get 3-4. Right? And practicing that dissonance so that we know that that's right. Again, a lot of what we do for, like I talked about in the musicianship sessions, is if you can name something, if you can say, oh, that's a C flat major chord above a B flat, then you know not only what to listen for, so that you know that your choir is singing the right notes, but then you can help them know what to listen for. And just say, yeah, altos and basses, you're in dissonance. All right, let's figure out how to do it, right? That's an important part of conducting, is anticipating problem spots and figuring out a strategy to mitigate them as soon as possible. After I went through and kind of did my best to circle all the dissonances, and there are a lot in this piece, then I started singing it. And I went through and sang, you know, maybe a page of the soprano, page of the alto, a page of the tenor, and made sure that I knew exactly how I wanted to phrase it, right? And so you can see here, this is not written in the music. Lauritsen didn't write these hairpins, I did. You'll notice that I want the bass and soprano to do a little mezzo di voce, but the tenor and alto not to, right? So I've made choices here, and as we've now moved from that objective thing to subjective things. This is my interpretation. Now that I've gone through it over and over and over again, now I feel comfortable enough, having sung it, having looked at the harmony, knowing the Italian, I feel now comfortable enough to start making phrasing decisions. And then at the very end, what I have left to do is really being able to hear the piece in detail. I feel like I can hear it, I can follow along in silence to that recording in my head, but I don't feel like it's specific enough yet. So I'm gonna be spending the next kind of 10 hours on this piece, trying to get it in my head very specifically, and then part of what being a conductor is trusting this process that if your interpretation is solid enough in your head, it will subconsciously evidence itself in your gesture. Even if you don't know that you're showing the text stress per se, that if you believe that the text stress is there and you have an interpretation about it, it will manifest itself in your gesture. I know that might sound a little hippy-dippy, but it really is true. That's what conducting is. So I hope that this was helpful to kind of get into the conductor's process here a little bit. I'll get some questions here, and then we're going to go on to some intangible tasks that we do. Yes, I see a couple things commenting about all the pen marks. I understand that that is stressful. I know we always teach pencil only, but these are my scores, right? I bought them, and I remark a score every time I conduct it. So even if I've come back to this piece 10 years from now, I'll probably order a new copy of it. I'll definitely refer to this, but I'll go through that discipline of remarking every score that I have. Now, if you were borrowing music from maybe a college or high school choir program, yes, of course, you should only use pencil because that isn't your score. Let's see, there was one other one. Oh, here's a good one. What are the zigzag lines? Those have to do with slowing down and speeding up. So you'll see here, this coordinates with molto rit, right? So I slow down, right, a backwards arrow, And then the subdivide is these kind of slash marks. Later in the piece, let me see, he marks a stringendo somewhere here. And then that means speed up, right? Poco stringendo. So I mark it there. It's just a graphic depiction. You know, when you're in the heat of battle in a performance or something, conductors are not reading music specifically. We're not like, oh, that's a good C flat basis. No, we're looking at big picture at that moment, right? So it's just a way to remind me of it. Again, this isn't that I can't conduct a piece without marking it, right? I can read the time signature change. I can memorize that there's a rallentando or stringendo or whatever. For me, it's really about the discipline of marking it, over marking it. And to me, that helps get into the process of learning it and making sure that I really know it. When I taught conducting, when I was teaching college, I always shared the story that the pastor who took me through the confirmation process said that your Bible is not a relic, right? Your Bible should be marked and have coffee rings on it and be beat up, right? From use. It isn't something to be afraid of. And I feel that way, especially if you own your music. Mark it, beat it up. That's the point. And when you do that, you're going to know that music at a fundamentally deeper level than if you didn't do that. Okay, let's go on to some intangible tasks that we do as conductors. First, I think it's really important that we stay current on research and performance practice, right? That we are current, we're reading journals, we're reading reviews of other performances, we're seeing what other conductors are doing. There's always research coming out about, like, the size of Bach's choir or orchestra. How many singers was he writing for? And yeah, we're probably gonna do cantatas with more than 8 singers, but knowing that might influence our interpretation. So I think that's really important. We need to read, watch, and listen to the zeitgeist, right? What's happening in other art forms? What is the dance world talking about? What is visual art? What is literature? Reading novels, reading other good writing helps us understand what's happening in the world and then to respond to it through our medium, which is music. I think conductors also need to be networking, right? Going to other ensembles' performances, watching performances, right? YouTube, Spotify, all these things have made it easier and easier to stay connected with what other groups are doing. For me, I'm also very interested in supporting composers who are writing today. So networking with them and asking for what music they're writing, what they're thinking about today is an important job. The last part of what I want to talk about tonight is the most delicate part. And I think some of you have maybe alluded to it in some of your questions. And that is what Weston Noble referred to as creating the special world. This is what makes us love choir. I think most of us don't sing in choir because we want to sing that C flat major chord over B flat perfectly. Maybe that's what we get to eventually over time. But the reason that we sing in choir is because it helps us feel connected to other people, and it helps us be part of something that's bigger than ourselves. And part of creating that sense is the conductor's responsibility, right? The ways that I could think of that we do this is really emphasizing joy over fear, right? That we are excited when we are successful. Charles Bruffy, great American conductor, said once that people don't sing really well when they're crying, right? So not taking away that intimidation and really focusing instead on encouragement and having high standards, but being with the choir as they strive to achieve them. I think a lot of this comes from really viewing the choir not as there to do your bidding as the conductor, but really as a collection of individuals. And it's really important that we have relationships with ensemble members, that we know them, and that we see them as people who, you know, have good days and bad days, just like we do as conductors, and that then we are able to see them and motivate them to continue to improve, all while having high standards, right? It's not a zero-sum game. A lot of this is getting to this idea of us, right? That we are doing this together. It's not a us versus them feeling. It's like some of those cartoons maybe demonstrated where the conductor was mad at the players and the players were mad at the conductor. No, this is something that we are doing together. And really, I think what this comes down to is vulnerability. And this is really what Weston Noble preached. And it took me a long time to really understand it, what he meant by that. Because I think for a long time, conductors, when we're young and we're training, we're trying to be kind of beyond reproach, this taskmaster who knows everything and has predicted every mistake you're going to make and knows how to solve it. That is certainly important, and I hope you can tell that I believe some of that is, you know, planning and being prepared is really important. But I think it's really getting past that and being vulnerable with your choir and sharing why you believe in a piece, inspiring them to believe in the piece too, and to share your vision. Even if it's not their favorite piece, there's somewhat of a sales job, right? And some of that is being vulnerable yourself and talking and being human with them. And I think that these factors then combine into making the special world happen. I guess what I'm saying is that choir is really seeking beauty together. That's what we're doing. And that's why this pandemic has been so challenging for us, right? Because what we do, our core, is not possible right now because we have to stay alive, right? I mean, I'm not knocking that. Social distancing is a good thing, but it's been very painful, right? Because this pursuit of beauty can only happen with other people. And that's what makes choir so beautiful, right? We can't, if you were a pianist, you can still play your piano at home, right? The pandemic has not taken that away. But choir is only possible when a group of people who might believe different things religiously or politically, whatever, come together, put that stuff aside, and reach for a more noble goal, which is beauty and togetherness. And to me, the onus of creating that special world is on the conductor. And it's a shared responsibility with the ensemble. But to me, I take that very seriously. And I'm looking forward to one day being able to share that with all of you, hopefully soon. I just also want to just point out, and this is my last slide, so I'll take some questions after this, but I want to point out that being a good conductor is, you have to take care of yourself first, right? If you're going to kind of shepherd other people, you have to kind of make sure your house is in order. So taking care of your physical, mental, spiritual, emotional health is really important. It's also important to have other creative hobbies. Almost every conductor I know loves to cook, loves to garden. I believe all of my conducting teachers were woodworkers. And I think these hobbies kind of are similar to conducting, right? You see a weedy, overgrown garden bed, and you can envision a beautiful garden. And a lot of the work is not glamorous to get it there. Just like the score study is a lot of time just alone, marking music. But it's kind of that vision of what can be, what is possible, that is native to not only to music, but to gardening or woodworking or cooking. And I think that conductors need to find that experience because it feeds us at a deep level. We need to spend time with others outside of music, right? Conducting is a people business, right? That's what we are. And we have to know lots of different types of people and have lots of different exchanges with people and not be in kind of only around other musicians. I think it's really important to kind of, if we're going to respond to the world around us like we should as artists, then we have to be part of the world around us too. To me, one of the best ways to do this is to get into nature, to realize that spending all your time only on scores, deciding if it's staccato or leggero, that's a small problem compared to kind of geological time, right? I have a great friend, composer, Gregory W. Brown, who was a geology major as an undergraduate. And he always talks about that helped him see music differently, right? That when you're measuring things in eons, your problems seem different now. And I think that, to me, nature helps me kind of remember to zoom out, right? In the score study process, we zoom so much in on every detail, but the most important step is zooming back out and having something to say through all these details. And being in nature helps me kind of see the forest through the trees, if you will. All right, I'll take a few more questions before we have our moment of Zen. Carol Metzger says, how does the process you go through as a conductor compare to the process we do as singers? Well, I don't know what you do as a singer, but for me, as someone who's sung in choirs for many, many years, for me, I, you know, would show up and sing the notes and go home, right? And, you know, I was certainly a good student, but I was not looking at what the sopranos were doing, right? I was concerned with the tenor part and making sure I could do it, and then I'd leave, right? And so what I think I do, similar to that iceberg, is I go at a much deeper level. You know, when did Lauridsen write the Madrigali? 1993. What was he doing? Why was it? How does this fit? How does this compare to his Lux Aeterna, right? So I'm looking at it as a much deeper and wider perspective than someone who comes to choir, gets a copy of this, looks at it, sings it, and maybe remembers it 5 years later or not, right? I think I'm looking deeper and wider on each piece than I would if I was singing it. Dan says, what inspired you to conducting versus being a performer such as a soloist? That's a good question. And frankly, I often miss singing because it's one of the kind of unfortunate things as you conduct more and more, you're on the other side of the podium and you're not singing. So I do try and sing as much as I can. I've done some solos recently and enjoy, I've taken voice lessons on and off throughout my career. So I think that's important too, to just kind of have, keep your chops up, my chops up, and to make sure that I kind of remember what it's like to be on the other side a little bit. And to be maybe reasonable in what I'm asking people to do, if you know, to make sure I can do that thing that I'm asking people to do. In terms of why I chose it, I just like the opportunity, like I said to Carol, to go in depth on a piece, to be able to devote time to studying a wide variety of music. And for me, I just really enjoy the process of helping other people discover this passion for music that I have, and to share it with them and to inspire them and validate what they feel as deeply as I do. I think that's all the questions I'm seeing. I'll take one last one. Conducting hands versus stick. I do both, right? My graduate teacher, Tim Stalter at the University of Iowa, I love him dearly. He always gave a lecture to use a baton or not use a baton. Why ask the question? We learned to be very comfortable with both a baton and without a baton. I think it's a really big, messy question. I use a baton frequently, and not just when I'm working with an orchestra. I've done plenty of unaccompanied pieces with a baton. Sometimes you just want that extra clarity that a baton gives you. I've also done unaccompanied pieces without a baton. I think that's maybe what people are more used to seeing. I've also done orchestral pieces without a baton, which is maybe a little unusual for the players to get used to, but I think it's perfectly fine to ask them to watch your hand instead of a stick. And it allows you to have, I think, a little bit more vulnerability and more expressivity because you don't have this foreign object in your hand. So that said, I do both and go back and forth, even within a concert, of using them or without. I will say that I usually make that decision of whether I'm going to use a baton before the rehearsal process. So if I'm going to use a baton in a performance, I'm going to use it throughout the rehearsal process so everybody's used to it. Likewise, if I'm not going to use baton, I'm not going to use it in rehearsal either. So I try and help people get used to what they're going to see. All right, a couple just housekeeping things before we have our moment of zen. First of all, thank you for being here. I've really been enjoying our Monday nights together. I hope you are too. I hope they're helpful and something different that you can do, and that we're all doing this together, even though we are separate. Join me next week. I'm going to be talking about little known unaccompanied gems. I picked three pieces that I love dearly that I think people should know more. And they're by the composers Mouton, Victoria, and Rossi. So these are all Renaissance era pieces. And then the following week, we're going to do three accompanied gems that people might not know about. And I'll talk about the composer and why I love this piece, and then we'll listen to each one. So join me next week. A link to the registration page is in the video description below. I hope that you will also share this with family members, friends, your choir director. We're really proud of what we're putting out, and we would love as many people as possible to join us. I got a great note from a choir, Pacific Choir in Vancouver, that they are watching this and enjoying it, and that's great. Thank you for being here, and you know, have at it. Invite as many people as you know to join us. Thank you also for those of you who have donated. We really appreciate it. Of course, there's no pressure. We understand these are difficult times for everyone. But if you are able to donate, we would appreciate it. All the links to these pages are in the video description below. And I just want to say thank you very much for any generosity you can offer. All right, our moment of Zen tonight is a wonderful part song by a German composer who is actually a conductor of the Berlin Zing Academy, named Georg Schumann. And this is a setting of the text from Psalm 23 that goes, "And though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me." And you'll notice at the beginning that altos start the piece, and the melodic line is very kind of meandering, and it's a little disorienting. What key are we in? Where are we going? And it's depicting this wandering in the darkness. And then by the end of the piece, and it's a very short little part song, at the end of the piece, we have these beautiful, lush chords on the word "Tröste mich," which means "comfort me." The words mean "comfort me." And I think that this really is a good kind of pictorial depiction, if you will, of the text. So please enjoy this piece by Georg Schumann. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. I hope you're doing well and staying healthy. And I hope that you will join me next week for another session of CMS University. Until then, I wish you well and have a good evening.